Okay, so thank you very much, Wojtek, for an overly generous introduction. And by the way, putting the summer school together like this is not easy. So we should thank all the organizers who've done a great job. Now, many of you are students, and you know that the people who do the real work are the students. The professors only just come on stage and talk about it. So in this particular case, the person who did the real work is Jonathan Ponniah, who is here, who will be graduating in a few weeks and joining the center as a postdoc. And so the plan is I'm going to give a overview for about an hour, and Jonathan, who knows real details, who knows the real work, will talk about it for the rest of the time. Okay? And towards the end, we'll have an open floor kind of a thing, so we can have a discussion about anything. Okay, future problems, challenges, anything. All right? Okay. So basically, what we are after is a clean slate approach to security of wireless networks. That is, we want to start afresh and design the field the way that we would have designed it if we had started right at the beginning and there was no field. So that's the idea. Okay? So that, of course, is an ambitious goal, and there's a lot of resistance. Every time you talk to somebody who knows this field, they you're touching all kinds of sore points and things like that. Okay. All right. So the focus is this. The focus is multi-hop wireless networks. So what is multi-hop wireless networks? You have a bunch of wireless nodes, and let us say that you want to send information from this node, packets from this node to this node. Then you send packets to this one, then that sends to this, then this, then this, then this. So it takes many, many hops for packets to go from their source node to their destination node. So that is why they're called multi-hop wireless networks. They're also ad hoc. Ad hoc means there is no plan as such. Suddenly these nodes show up and they want to form a network. So for example, all the people in this room may want to form an ad hoc wireless network. So we are talking about how to construct a network from ground zero, where there's nothing, okay? The locations of the nodes may not be known. The number of nodes may not be known, et cetera. Who wants to talk to whom may not be known. There are many, many issues, okay? But you want to form a network, and that field is called ad hoc multi-hop wireless networks. What are some uses? There are many, many uses. One, for example, could be, and this actually happened when there was Hurricane Katrina in New Orleans. All the cell towers, everything are down, so there is no infrastructure. So a bunch of people actually went and set up an ad hoc wireless network without any infrastructure. You can also imagine situations like this where you may want to form a network just in a room. Okay, and as you can also imagine, the Department of Defense is very interested in these things because on the battlefield, they cannot lay down cables, okay? So they want to form wireless networks. So there are many, many, many possibilities. People are talking of body area networks and all kinds of things. Okay, so we're talking of networks where packets possibly multi-hop from sources to destinations. There is no pre-existing infrastructure, so there are no wires as such. There is no centralized controller. There is nobody who's a central node who's directing everything. No such thing. So these kinds of networks are called peer-to-peer networks. Everybody is of the same level. There's no boss, okay? And all the decisions have to be made in a distributed way. Because there is no leader, there is no central boss. All the decision making has to be done by all the people participating in the network. So the nodes themselves have to make a lot of decisions. So what are these decisions? For example, every time they send a packet, they have to decide what is the power level of the packet. Should it be a low power or high power, right? That's one decision. They also have to decide when to transmit a packet. Should I transmit it now or 1 second later, okay? And they have to decide the route. Should I go this way or should I go this way? So they have to decide routes. And they have to decide schedules. How do these packets get relayed? Everything. So all the decision making has to be figured out by the nodes themselves. Okay. And in order to achieve that, to achieve such a result where a bunch of nodes can spontaneously be born and form a network, there are many, many protocols that are needed. In fact, there's a complete protocol suite that is needed. And what are these protocols? For example, there could be a protocol for power control, for medium access control, for routing, for all kinds of things, okay? All right, so that's the context of our system. Now, what is the motivation for our work? So the motivation is to re-examine how the field of security has been developed and to rewrite it from the ground up. Okay. So let's go and see what actually has been happening. So the usual approach in many systems, including in wireless networks, okay, has been the following. So people develop protocols, a bunch of protocols, to obtain good performance. Okay. So they do some protocol design. And then they implement it. And then at that point, somebody discovers an attack. They figure out that there is some loophole and some bad guy can bring the system down. So some attack is identified. Then what happens is people scramble and come up with a defense. Okay? By the way, very often it's the same person. In the same paper, we'll identify the attack and provide a solution. Okay? But whatever it is, vulnerabilities are identified and fixed. And the defense, it should be noted, is for that particular attack. So whatever attack you have identified, you plug that hole. Then somebody comes along later and identifies another hole, and then you fix that, and so on. And this is the way the field goes on. Every day, I'm sure you get patches to your Microsoft Internet Explorer or Word or Windows or whatever, right? Every day they keep plugging holes. That's exactly what has happened in this particular case. And this is not just fiction, this is actually the way the field has developed in this particular case. So there are many attacks that have been identified, many protocols that try to fix these attacks and so on, okay? All of these are papers with thousands of citations, thousands. Each paper of this may have a few thousand citations, okay? That's how well known these things are. Now what is the result? What's the result of all this process? The result is a sequence of patches. Patch one, patch two, patch three, etc. Okay? There's an arms race. Every time you patch it, I find some other hole. You patch it, I find some other hole. It's an arms race. Okay? And what is the difficulty? The difficulty with the arms race is that you never know at any stage what else could be a hole in the future. You don't have any guarantees. All I know is that I was good with respect to the previous things that have been, holes that have been discovered, but I cannot give you any guarantees about what else may be out there. So you're always living in a perpetual state of insecurity. Okay? We don't know what other attacks are possible. So bottom line, there are no guarantees of security. That is exactly where the field of security is. Exactly. All the protocol design. Okay. All right. That's what we want to change. So let's go and see what is the problem of defending against attacks. Okay, what's the problem? So the problem is this, okay? So if you give me a particular protocol, so let us say you've developed a protocol, and then you identify a particular attack, I can harden it. Maybe I can fix the protocol, make it harden it against to be resistant to that attack. But the point is that the hardened protocol is immune only to that particular attack. Just the one thing that you have plugged it for, that's the only thing it's immune to. Now the fundamental question is, how can we develop a protocol that is immune to all attacks? That's the issue. I don't want to harden it against one attack, I want to harden it against all attacks. How to do that? The challenge is this, we cannot even list all the attacks. There's so many attacks, can't even think of them, right? So if I can't even list them, how on earth can I develop defenses, attack by attack? So if you want to pursue this approach, you have to list all your attacks and defend against all of them, but you can't even list them. So how can you do it? So that's the challenge. So this calls for a system theoretic approach. You need to view it as a system, okay? And theoretically. Okay? So the way I'm going to think about it is that every attack is a particular policy in some model of the system. By the way, what is a policy? A policy is like a manual, okay? Every page in the manual says, if you see these things, take this action. On the next page, it'll say, if you see these things, take this action. Another page, it says, if you observe these things, take particular action. So a policy is a set of actions for each possible state of the system or each possible set of information you know about the system. Okay, that's a policy, okay? So every attack is also a policy, right? That means that what the attacker is saying is that if you see these things, then take advantage and do the following, right? That's what the attacker is saying to himself or herself, right? So an attack is a policy. So, I'm going to think of attacks as policies by the bad guy, by the malicious nodes. Okay? So the goal now is not to defend against a particular policy, but to defend, develop a defense for the model itself. So I have a model of the way things, the world works. Okay. Newtonian laws, that's my model. I want to allow within that model, I want to allow all policies. And then for that very model, I want to have a defense. So it's a model-based defense. Okay. So to recap, I'm going to assume a model of capabilities for the attacker. So I'm not saying the attacker should do this or that. I'm saying these are all the things an attacker could do. Capabilities of the model of the attacker, they describe a model of possibilities, and then we're going to defend against that entire model. Now this is also in the distributed computing community, it's also called Byzantine behavior of malicious nodes. So Byzantine means they can do whatever they want. Okay, so the problem is the following. Sorry? Yes. Okay, so I think that's right. So the thing is that, so actually I guess the Byzantium was the eastern half of the Roman Empire. Constantinople was the capital, right? And apparently the generals of Byzantium were pretty conniving sorts of people, okay? So there's a very famous problem in distributed systems called the Byzantine generals problem. Some of you may have heard of it. So the Byzantine generals problem, and let me just say a few words about it just to tell you what kind of problems these people look at. So the Byzantine generals problem is the following. Let us say that there's a blue army, okay? A blue army out in the center. And there is a red army that wants to attack the blue army, okay? Now let us suppose that this red army has two generals. There's a general out here for the red army and there's a red general out here for the red army. So there's two red army generals, there's a blue army in the middle. Now, if only one of the Red Army generals attacks the Blue Army, the Red Army will fail. So if this Red Army, this person attacks, it will fail. Or if only the other Red Army general attacks, it will fail. But if both of them attack, then it will succeed. Okay? Now the problem is that these two Red Army generals have to coordinate their attack. Now what does coordinate mean? Coordinate means that you should know that I'm going to attack and I should know that you're going to attack, so we both attack at the same time. And not only that, I should know that you should know that I should know that you should know. Okay? And the problem is that these two, let us say these two Red Army generals can communicate only by sending some spies through the Blue Army to the other side. So every time the one Red Army general sends a message to the other Red Army general, it could get lost. So he doesn't know whether he reached it. So he doesn't know. So supposing one general says, I'm going to attack at 8 o'clock. And he sends a message. He doesn't know whether the other guy got it. So he doesn't know whether the other person will cooperate and attack at the same time, right? And let us say that the message reaches this general and the general sends back an acknowledgement. Now this other general doesn't know whether to attack or not because he doesn't know whether the first person got their reply, okay? Even if this other person got the reply, he doesn't know that the other person knew that he got the reply. So the point is that it is impossible for these two people to agree and to know that they've agreed and so on, okay? And this is symptomatic of the larger class of problems in distributed computing, where you have a bunch of nodes and they have to achieve some consensus or something, and they're operating on the basis of an unreliable system. So this whole field of trying to achieve consensus over an unreliable thing. And what is unreliable? Unreliable means the underlying network or something can do all kinds of crazy things. Okay, so those are the Byzantine possibilities. So this is a fundamental problem in distributed computing. Okay, and by the way, so we, as I said, I'm going to give you an overview, and then Jonathan, who knows much more about these things than me, will talk about it. And so towards the end, you know, you can engage in a discussion about some of these problems. Okay? So you see that this Byzantine kind of problem is one of the things we'll have to deal with, right? We have a network where people are behaving badly and somehow we want to communicate, and so we have to deal with this. So basically what we've done invokes a lot of distributed computing, work in distributed computing, and what we are actually doing is we're not just doing distributed computing, we're also looking at security, we're looking at wireless, we're doing a lot of things, and we're trying to put together a complete system for security. So distributed computing is just one portion, part of it. Communication theory is another part of it. Security is another part of it, et cetera, et cetera. Is that answer the question? Any questions about that? Okay. So what is the issue here? We'll assume that there are some nodes which are good, some are bad. Okay? Now the good nodes have to publish a protocol. They'll say this is the way the network will operate, and the good nodes, of course, will have to follow that, right? So basically, the good people will write down the set of rules by which they will operate, and they want other people to operate, and they know that each other they will operate that way. So they design a protocol, publish it for everybody to see, and then they follow it. That's what's happening with your internet protocols, right? They have a RFC, request for comments, that's published out there, and all the nodes are hopefully implementing it, okay? Of course, there are bad nodes that may not implement it. But the good people have to publish a protocol and follow it. So now we get a game. So our work also has a game theoretic flavor, a zero-sum game flavor. There are good and bad people. So the good people are designing protocols and following it. What are the bad people doing? They can do whatever they want. Whatever is within their capability, they can do. And I'll describe to you some of these possibilities. Okay, so the question now, by the way, I'm spending a lot of time even getting to the formulation of the problem. Okay? I'm spending a lot of time telling you how we are approaching this problem. I'm spending a lot of time even telling you that there is a problem, right? So this is all at the meta stage, right? You know, because a lot of times in your research, somebody says, hey, here's an open problem, solve it, okay? But what we are doing is not at that level. We're saying, wait, there is this field of security. Let's look at it. Let's see what, how we would dissect it, how we would reformulate it, etc. Okay? So a lot of my talk will be to get to that strategic aspect of research, not just the tactical aspect. If you play chess, you know the difference between strategy and tactics. So this is a strategic aspect of research. How do you choose a problem? How do you formulate it? How do you know what's a good problem? What's a good area, etc.? So we're going to spend a lot of time on that. So, in exactly that level, the question that we're asking is, what is a model of the system for which we can develop a theory and a complete set of protocols? So nobody has told me the model of the system, right? I mean, there are many, many assumptions that I could make. So the question I'm asking is, supposing I want to approach security as a game between protocols and Byzantine behavior, then what is a model of the system for which I can carry out this program of research? What is a model for which I can develop a theory and come up with something interesting? That's the question. Okay? All right. There's one other question that comes up, and that is performance. See, the point is that usually, you know, people design protocols, they build systems for good performance, okay, for high throughput or something like that. Only subsequently do they think of security, all right? So what we said is, okay, let's do something that is secure. But of course, you know, what is the most secure thing that you could do? You could just lock yourself up in your room and not talk to anybody and you're completely secure, right? But that's totally useless because there's no performance. You're not getting any throughput and so on. So what about performance? And the reason why we build a system is for performance, right? So don't just do security. What about performance? Now, usually first they develop performance, then address security. We want to do the reverse. So I've told you the way I'm going to approach security, as a game between protocols and Byzantine behaviors. Now what about performance? Okay, so the thing is that whatever performance metric you specify, there may be many protocols which give you good performance. Okay? There may be many, many defenses against attacks, many ways of defending yourself. How should I choose among them? Some may have low performance, some may have high performance. Right? So, for those of you who know something about queuing theory or networking, there is something called throughput optimality. Throughput optimality means you get the maximum number of bits per second through from source to destination. That's called throughput optimality. But there may be many ways of getting a large throughput, high throughput. Some of them may have more delay, some may have less delay. So what we are after is not just throughput optimality, but minimum delay. In fact, it turns out that if you minimize delay, you automatically get throughput optimality. Because if some packets are not delivered, their delay would be infinity, and the average delay would be infinity. Okay. So the point I want to make is that throughput optimality is relatively easy to obtain, but minimum delay may be harder. So in exactly the same way, there may be many protocols that can defend against attacks, but to design something that can not only defend against attacks but give me good performance may be more difficult. Okay, that's the issue. Okay, so the way we are going to address this is we're going to postulate a utility function. Now, utility function, this is what economists use. They say if there's a bunch of agents in a market or whatever, and they take certain actions, then me as a particular agent may derive some utility from it, okay? And if you're a different agent, you may get some other utility. So what we are going to say is that when the network does some work, the people in the network derive a certain utility. Okay? So this is like a reward function or the negative of a cost function. It's a utility function. In our case, we'll assume that the utility depends on the throughputs. So X is the vector of throughputs. The throughput for this source destination pair, the throughput for this source destination pair, etc. So you list all the source destination pairs and list all the throughputs that you give them. That's a throughput vector. In information theory, this is called a rate vector, right? So X is a rate vector. So for each rate vector, I'm assuming that there is some utility that the network derives. Okay? Now we get a zero-sum game. So there is some utility that is good for the network. The good guys, which are always shown in green, by the way, in my talk, the good people will design some protocols, they'll announce the protocols, and they will follow them. And they are trying to choose these protocols to maximize the utility. The bad nodes, shown in red, can do whatever they want. They can act as unreliably as they please, given their capabilities. And they want to minimize the utility. So, what we are after is a max-min solution. What is a max-min solution? Max-min is first, these people publish their protocols. That's where the max is out there. Then, subsequently, the bad people find the holes. So, this is important. So, first protocols are published, then somebody exploits holes. That's why it's called max-min. If you did the reverse, right, if the bad guys first announced what they would do, and then the good guys developed a protocol to defend against it, that would be min-max. Okay? If you think about it a little bit, it turns out that max-min is always smaller utility than min-max. If the good guys first disclose what they're going to do, and then the bad guys attack, that's a smaller utility than the bad guy saying first, this is what we'll do, and then the good guys optimize, right? So min-max always is more than max-min, okay? So we, of course, if the good guys are going to publish their protocol first, then the best that we can hope to attain is max-min. So is this clear? So we've now arrived at a game theoretic view of security, a maximum over protocols announced, designed, announced, and followed by the good people, and the minimum over the Byzantine behaviors of the bad ones. Okay, so question. So now we've moved further ahead. Can we develop a max-min optimal super protocol? Super protocol means a complete protocol suite that achieves this. Okay? And then there are some other questions. In my particular case, I'm talking of throughput. Okay. Now, throughput is a long-term notion of performance. Throughput is how many bits did you deliver in a very long period of time, right? So, throughput is a long-term notion. Now, perhaps you may also be interested in transient performance. We'll talk about some of those issues, okay? And also, I haven't told you exactly how this utility function depends on the throughput. And it turns out that choosing this also actually has very interesting questions. I don't know, some of you may be economists, but you may know that there was a person called Roger Myerson who got the Nobel Prize in economics from Chicago, right? Myerson. So Myerson studied this whole issue of people strategically lying about their objectives and trying to grab more of a share of the pie and things like that. And he developed something called came up with this notion of incentive compatibility. How do you design incentives so that, the fundamental thing about economists is that they assume that everybody's selfish, right? Okay. So I hope there's no economists to contradict me here because it's not completely true. But for the sake of making a point here, let's assume that economists assume that all people are selfish, okay? So then the question is, given that we are dealing with selfish people, how can we design an incentive scheme that will make everybody behave? Okay? So that is called the problem of incentive compatibility. So here also, there's a very interesting question here. How should I design this utility function so that after we play this game, the net utility accrued to the good guys is even better than what it could be? Actually, this goes beyond Meyerson's problem, okay, which I'm not sure we'll have time to talk about it. Okay, so, question, can we develop a system theoretic, principled, holistic approach to security? Okay, where security is addressed first, not as an afterthought. Second, performance is addressed second, but it's not neglected. I'm going to actually optimize it. And not only that, I'm going to optimize it while preserving security. So I'm going to guarantee security and then maximize performance. Okay? And this is exactly the reverse of the usual approach, and this is why none of the security people, I mean, if I were to talk about it to a security community, they would boo me out of this room, okay? Because this is going against all the usual way of doing things. Okay, what is the security? So this is the objective, a system theoretic clean slate approach to secure wireless networking, provable security, and security should be provable. There have to be theorems, okay? And as long as the model assumptions are satisfied, the theorem is correct. That actually raises a fundamental question. You know, I think Box, was it Box who said this? Somebody, all models are wrong. Some are more useful. Okay, no matter what model, Newtonian model of the world is wrong. Einstein told us that. And probably the Einstein world is wrong. Model is wrong. So every model is an approximation of reality. So this approach is guaranteed only if the model assumptions are satisfied, and the model is not the complete truth, right? So the model assumptions itself could be attacked. So this is not the last word on security. But it is a far better place to be in. Instead of defending protocol attack by attack by attack, it's much better to defend model by model by model. I think that represents a huge evolution of the field. Say, I don't like your model, here's a better model. That's fine. Okay, but that's better than saying, I don't like your attack, here's another attack. Okay? We've elevated the game. Okay, so subsequently, yes, model assumptions can be attacked or challenged, and Jonathan will mention possibilities in that regard. Okay? And what ultimately we want is that somebody to come and write a paper and say, this is everything that we've done is wrong, here's a better model. I think if somebody does that, I think we'll be very, very happy. Okay? So we want to develop a complete suite of algorithms, protocols in this way. Now, how do you view this work at the end of the day? There are several views, okay? One view is that you can just think of it as an existence theorem. It's just a theorem that there is a way of developing security, just as an existence theorem. In mathematics, a big issue is existence theorems, okay? So you can just think of it as an existence theorem. Or if you like what we do a little bit more, you can say, hey, these algorithms also are interesting. So you can think of this as providing algorithms if you like them, if you don't have any objections to them. So you can think of that as suggestions for how to design the system. And so that is the security objective, and then the performance objective is max min optimality. Okay? Max is over protocol, min is over all actions of malicious nodes. Okay, so let me pause here for a second and ask, are there any questions that at this point, is our approach reasonably clear? I'm going to say a few more things to make it more precise, but is the idea how we are approaching it clear? Yes. Okay, so the question, if I can understand, hear you, which I cannot hear perfectly, is how do you specify, how do you know whether the node is good or bad, right? Okay, wonderful question. I'm going to declare anybody who follows the protocol is good, anybody who doesn't is bad. Okay, that's it. Good guys follow, bad guys don't. That's it. And there are actually some very subtle, interesting questions here. The utility function will be over the set of good nodes. It's very subtle but very important point. Okay? It'll show up in the slides, okay, but I may not emphasize it. Okay. Now, clearly, there's a lot of explanation needed, okay, given this very broad goals. So now, let me show you how we're going to make some of these things more concrete. So I want a complete suite of algorithms or protocols that will take you from startup. Startup means Hurricane Katrina, everything is wiped out, and then you, bunch of people drive with their jeeps with nodes, okay? That's startup. There's nothing existing. So these nodes show up. They're born. So I'm going to think of it as a big bang of the universe. There's a primordial birth of a bunch of nodes. That is the beginning. So in the beginning, there were nodes. Okay? Some of these nodes are good. This is the green people. Some of them are bad, the red people. Okay? So that's the starting point. Some good, some bad. The good guys don't know who the bad guys are. But the bad guys know everything. So bad guys know each other, who the, everything. Okay? The good people don't know who the bad people are. So kind of a worst case scenario. So that is the starting point. So the important point is this. I'm not telling you about how to operate an already existing network. I'm telling you how to even start a network all the way from the beginning. And where do I want to end up? I want to end up with a completely beautifully working network, a functional network. It's carrying data happily and it's optimized. So I want to go from this big bang to an optimal state of affairs. That's what a protocol suite should do. Okay. So I'm talking of all the handshakes needed for network formation. All the handshakes needed to know who else is there. Are they nearby? Are they far away? Who wants to talk to me? Who doesn't? All that will have to be figured out. And we have to go from there to here. Okay? Okay. So let me be a little bit more explicit now. What could possibly go wrong with the network if you have a bunch of bad nodes? So what can bad nodes do? How can they try to hurt you? Okay? A lot of things. What could they do? Well, one is they could refrain from relaying a packet. I send a packet to somebody and say, can you please send it to the other person, and they don't do it. They could advertise a wrong hop count. Now, you may know that one way some protocols in the internet work is by keeping track of distances of nodes from each other. So Illinois is far from California, but maybe Nevada is close to California. So they keep distance vectors to each other. And what the routing protocols do is they advertise their distance vectors, and other people take advantage of that to find short routes. So this is called the distributed Bellman-Ford algorithm. So basically, nodes advertise the logical topology or the topology of the network. Now, bad nodes could advertise a wrong hop count. For example, a bad node could say, hey, every state in the country is just one hop from me. Everybody in the US is one hop from me. Then, of course, I'll send you all my packets because you're very close to everybody, right? So that's like a black hole. Bad nodes could advertise a wrong hop count, a wrong logical topology. They can jam. They can just say, I'm not going to do anything intelligent. I'm just going to take my receiver power and just emit white noise, white Gaussian noise. that's called jamming. They could cause packet collisions. You know, one of the fundamental issues with a wireless network is that wireless is a shared medium. So that means we all share the spectrum in this location. So if I'm transmitting, if I'm talking to you, I don't want somebody else to be talking at the same time, right? Because then you get collisions, packets collide, and you cannot decode packets. So a bad node could transmit exactly when somebody else is transmitting and deliberately cause a packet collision. More generally, a bad node could behave uncooperatively versus vis-a-vis medium access. What is medium access? So it turns out that in the wireless world, we all have to cooperate just to talk to each other. In order for me to talk to you, this person should keep quiet, that person should keep quiet, that person should keep quiet. All the people surrounding my receiver should keep quiet, right? So we all need to cooperate to talk. And one of the very interesting problems in wireless is that in order to talk, we need to cooperate. But in order to achieve cooperation, we need to talk. I should tell him, please keep quiet. But that means I need to talk to him. But in order to talk to him, he should keep quiet. But the reason I'm asking him to keep quiet is because I want to talk to him. So what comes first, the chicken or the egg? Should I talk first or achieve cooperation first? And that's called the medium access control problem. So a bad node could try to follow that up. Okay. He could disrupt all attempts at cooperative scheduling. You know, one way to get maximum performance out of a network is that if everybody cooperates and schedules packets and helps each other out and so on, and bad nodes could just interfere in all kinds of strange ways. They could drop an ACK. You know, one of the things in wireless is that, when I send a packet, I want to make sure you got it, so you send me an acknowledgement back. So this person may say, I'm not going to send an acknowledgement. Kind of fouls everything up. They could refuse to acknowledge neighbor's handshake. So I can say, are you there? And this person doesn't reply to me. So I don't even know this person is next. Okay, or they could do some other things. And not only that, it could behave inconsistently. Sometimes it could be good, sometimes it could be bad, sometimes it talks to you, sometimes it doesn't, sometimes it says acts, sometimes it doesn't, sometimes it jams. It could do all these things. And all of that is what I mean by Byzantine behavior. Okay, so Byzantine means these are all capabilities of a bad node, and it can do whatever it wants. Okay. All right, so what are the main results? Okay, so now I'm going to take you to the end product, the end of this theory. So I've told you the beginning, the model. So what have I done so far? I've told you some philosophy, okay? How should you approach this problem? I've told you how to strategically formulate it. Then I've told you a little bit more concrete details about what makes the problem challenging, this Byzantine behavior. I've told you I want to go from startup to an optimized network. And now, I'm not going to tell you about how we do it, but I'll tell you the end result, okay? The final theorems. And then I'll come back and tell you a little bit about in between, or actually since we're running out of time, I may even stop prematurely and hand over to Jonathan. We'll decide how to go about it. Okay, so what are the main results? Theorem. I'm going to give you a protocol suite, and that protocol suite will result in a network that is max min optimal with respect to the utility function. So I'm going to achieve my objective. Okay? So it will achieve max over protocols, min over Byzantine behaviors of whatever utility function you give me. You tell me the utility function, I'll deliver this result to you. Okay, for every choice of utility function. Actually, going to give you an even stronger result. Now you can ask what could be even stronger than max min. Actually, I'm going to get min max. So the bad guys may as well tell you right in the beginning what they're going to do. I'll show you that I'll give you a performance which is not just max min, which is min max. And in game theory, when max min equals min max, we say that there is a saddle point. What is a saddle point? I don't know how many of you ride horses, but if you ever seen the saddle of a horse, it's shaped laterally it's shaped like this, longitudinally it's shaped like this, right? So I can draw things. But if you look at it in the X cross section, it looks like this. If you look at it in the Y cross section, it looks this. So one is concave, the other is convex, okay? And at the center of the saddle, the maximum over the X direction is equal to the minimum over the Y direction, right? So at that saddle point, max min equals min max. Max over X, min over Y equals min over Y, max over X. So that's the saddle point, and that's why when min max equals max min, people say that there's the game, the zero-sum game, has a saddle point. Okay. In fact, I'm going to give you an even stronger result. In fact, I'm going to show you that the bad guys don't benefit from all these Byzantine behaviors. They can actually just do one of two things. They can either cooperate or jam. So we'll design a set of protocols. So ultimately, the bad guys, if they play all these games, they're only fooling themselves, not anybody else. They may as well just be good or jam. Jamming is a dumb activity, right? I mean, anybody with a radio transmitter can jam, right? Just send noise. And nobody can stop a note from jamming. So we're going to reduce, we're going to show that these Byzantine people don't benefit by any smart strategies. They may as well just jam and or cooperate. In fact, they can do both. They can jam and cooperate. What do you mean jam and cooperate? On some instances they can jam, on some they can cooperate. Okay? In a consistent way. So requires a little more subtlety to explain this. For every set of concurrent transmissions that the network calls upon, they have to decide either to jam or to cooperate, and then to repeat that consistently. Okay. So basically, the freedom to maneuver for the bad guys is completely restricted by our protocol suite. Okay, so that's the big theorem. Okay, so bottom line, we will achieve min over the bad nodes, either jamming or cooperating, max over all protocols of the utility function on each concurrent transmission set. Let me tell you what a concurrent transmission set is. For people in graph theory, you may have heard of independent sets. So if you have a bunch of nodes, I say that a set of nodes is an independent set if there are two nodes that are adjacent to each other. For example, if you have all the integers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 in a row, and you draw an edge between 1 and 2, between 2 and 3, and 3 and 4, then the odd numbers form an independent set, because there are no two odd numbers that are connected by an edge. Similarly, the even numbers form an independent set. They're not connected by an edge, right? So in graph theory, there's a notion of independent set. In a wireless network, nodes in an independent set can transmit at the same time because they don't collide with each other. Okay, I have to be more precise, but roughly that's the idea. So, on each independent set, the bad guys can either choose to jam or cooperate consistently. So if they do jamming on a particular independent set this time, the next time also they should jam. If they cooperate this time, they should cooperate. Now, the thing is that nobody can prevent anybody from jamming, and nobody can prevent you from cooperating. So you cannot get a better result than this. It's not possible. That's why it's min-max. All other Byzantine behaviors, it's not sending an act, not acknowledging magic, all that doesn't help. They can do it, but they won't help themselves. Lying, etc. doesn't help. Okay. There's one other big point I want to make, and that is, why would a bad node ever cooperate? And this gets to one of the questions that was implicitly raised. You know, it turns out that sometimes a bad note can cause more damage by cooperating than by jamming. I mean, sometimes you can hurt me more by pretending to be my friend than doing some nasty thing rather than just shouting at me, okay? Roughly like that, okay? So sometimes a bad note can hurt more by cooperating. I'll give you an example. It depends on the utility function. So let us say the utility function is the minimum of the throughputs. Let us say there are 10 source destination pairs. So there are 10 throughputs, and the throughput vector is a 10-dimensional vector. Okay? Let us say the utility of the throughput vector is the minimum throughput. So this is the socialist view of the world. I'm trying to lift the floor. So there's a bunch of people in society, and I'm going to measure the utility of society by the wealth of the poorest person. Okay? So the utility is the minimum throughput that I've given to anybody. Okay? And let us say my goal is to maximize the minimum. So I would like to be as fair as possible. I want to raise the standard of living of the poorest person. Okay? That's my throughput. Supposing that's the throughput, then you can already imagine that a bad person can declare himself to be poor and get a lot of attention, right? So for that particular utility function, cooperation can hurt more. And here's a particular concrete way of seeing that. Let us say there are three nodes, A, B, C. Three nodes only. And A and B are the good nodes. They're in green. And C is a bad node, a malicious node. And let us say that C is far away from AB. So it's very far. So this distance X, I'm sorry, this is the throughput XAB. This distance from B to C is very large. The distance from A to B is small. Okay? Now let us say that in this problem, there are two throughputs of interest. The throughput from A to B, XAB, and the throughput from C to B, XCB. Two throughputs. Okay? And let us say the utility is the minimum of these two numbers. C is far away. Now, because C is far away, whenever it transmits, it causes very little, there's very low signal strength here. Because it's talking from far away, B hears C very, very softly. The received signal strength is very low. Okay? At the same time, if he wants to jam, the amount of noise he creates for AB is also small because he's shouting from very far away, so he's not hurting his throughput too much. You follow? So if he's trying to talk, he gets very low received signal strength. If he's trying to jam, he creates very small noise. So if C decides to jam, it can only slightly reduce this throughput because it can only slightly increase the noise level. And I'm assuming that all of you know something about Shannon's result, that the throughput is related to the signal-to-noise ratio, okay? Log of 1 plus SNR. So if the SNR is hurt only a little bit, the throughput is hurt only a little bit, okay? So if C jams, it can only reduce XAB slightly. In particular, if C is very, very far away, that means the distance from B and C, between B and C is infinite, then this throughput is not hurt at all. In fact, it's equal to what the maximal throughput that this person could get. In other words, if C were at infinity, it wouldn't hurt him at all. On the other hand, if C says, I'm good, and I'm going to cooperate, now the utility function says there are two throughputs, and I have to take the smaller of them and help them. So then as C goes far away, the network will try to keep C happy because C is the poorer person. And to keep C happy, it'll have to spend most of the air time transmitting C's packets and not A's packets. So that means the throughput that A gets for AB will be zero. So C actually hurts AB more by cooperating and claiming a small signal strength than by jamming. So that is why, but that depends on this utility function. If the utility function is maximum fairness. But so now we get a very interesting question, a little bit like Meyerson's work on incentive compatibility. How would you design this utility function? This is clearly a bad utility function because if it hurts by the bad guys can hurt it. But supposing I say throughput is a total throughput, this plus this, then I won't pay any attention to C. Then he cannot hurt it, right? So some utilities could be hurt, some could not be hurt. That opens up a whole different strategic set of problems. Okay? All right. Okay, so that's why I say here that C can cause more harm by cooperating than by jamming. And that is why in the min-max here, C may jam and or cooperate. Okay. All right. So, again, let me give you the broad picture. What are the fundamental ingredients of our approach? Okay. So now I want to tell you a little bit more about the model. So I'm proceeding in a very nonlinear way. First, I told you some philosophy. Then I told you the goal as a game theory. Then I said something about going from startup to finish. I told you a little bit about the theorems. Now I'll tell you a little bit more about the model. Because I want to describe a model within which I can carry out this theoretical research agenda, right? Of developing a game theoretic strategic view of security. What is that model? What it should involve things of interest to the wireless people. It should involve all the distributed computing aspects. There are many aspects, right? Security aspects, cryptography aspects, etc. So this model will have to have touch all these bases, and at least at first order, it should make some sense, right? So that's the goal, to come up with some model that looks reasonable to start with, okay? Okay, I'm going to assume all the standard cryptographic primitives. Everything that cryptographers believe will assume, okay? So in particular, I'm going to assume that all packets are encrypted. Okay? And they cannot be decrypted by anybody except the intended recipient. Okay? So I'm going to assume public key cryptography, all the infrastructure. So bad nodes cannot create fake packets. So I cannot create a packet and say you sent it because I cannot sign it for you. So I'm going to assume all that cryptographic stuff. They cannot alter good packets because if you alter, then the signature gets altered, okay, without getting caught. So all the cryptography I'm going to assume. Right away, by the way, this puts it outside the domain of information theory because information theorists don't believe in cryptography. Tough luck, okay. This is, I believe, information theory's problem. At the moment, because information theory has to deal with computational complexity. Okay. Okay. I'm also going to assume clocks and synchronization. But this is strange, right? I'm suddenly bringing in the word clock and synchronization. Where did that come from? Why should that even be there? The reason is this: if you don't have a notion of time, you cannot talk of throughput. What's the definition of throughput? Bits per second. If you don't agree on what is a second, if 1 second to you looks like 1 hour to the other person, then the throughput, you don't even agree on throughput, so how can you minimize or maximize or do anything, right? So without a notion of time, you cannot even talk of throughput, and without throughput, you cannot talk of utility, and without utility, you cannot decide what to maximize. None of this makes sense. So there has to be a notion of time. Okay? So time has to be essential. Now, I'm actually going to go more and ask and devise protocols which yield a common notion of time. So my approach will be to do some synchronization that makes people agree on time. Okay? Now, that's not the only approach. and I'll comment on that in a second. But the reason I use it is because it's, I'm going to devise protocols which agree on time, and then I'm going to exploit that notion of time to do scheduling and temporal cooperation. So the way I'm going to achieve cooperation is first by agreeing on time and then cooperating. Now you could say, wait, that's unnecessary. You could just do event-based cooperation. When you hear this, do this. When you hear that, do that, without a notion of time. But it would be more difficult. The theory would be more difficult. This is something that we can do, and maybe Jonathan will do that in the future. So with the, so that's my reason. Okay. So cooperating scheduling will become enabled. So in my approach, so this is the way I'm going to approach it. Synchronization will be a fundamental ingredient. Okay, synchronization. All right, so here are the model assumptions, okay? There is some bounded domain. The only reason I'm having a bounded domain is because, you know, if somebody is at infinity, then I don't want to talk of zero signal to noise ratio, things like that. Just as you're bounded, it's fine, okay? There are n nodes. Some good, some bad. Okay. I know n. I'm going to assume that I don't need to know n. I know an upper bound for n. I'm going to assume that. Okay. There are other issues that we can talk about later. I'm going to assume a minimum distance between any two pair of nodes. And the only reason, I don't even need that, the only reason I'm going to assume that is if you assume a physical model of wireless networking, then there is something called transmit power, there is something called attenuation as a function of distance, path loss, and there's receive power. Now, if two things are infinitely close, then you have to define the notion of receive power, and there are singularities and things like that, so I'm not going to bother with that, so I'm going to assume there's a minimum. All nodes are separated by 1 millimeter. Okay. Actually, I don't need that because I can come up with a model which is not physical, physics based. Here's a big assumption and a big drawback. I'm going to assume the nodes are not mobile. Okay, so what we are developing is a theory for static networks. Now you can say, wait, what's the use of that? Well, maybe this theory could be used to make it the static theory could be used to build a quasi-static theory. What's a quasi-static theory? Suppose the speed of mobility is smaller than the speed of convergence of protocols, then I can do something. Okay, so that's subsequent work. But for the time being, nodes are not mobile. So this, again, as I said, my theory is model-based. Eventually, you'll have a better model. And that's the way I want this theory to evolve. Okay, so the next paper that any of you write, I want to see the word nodes are not mobile. Okay. By the way, we can get rid of all these physical assumptions about power and distance and attenuation and path loss and all those things. We can just directly get to the chase and assume there's a finite set of modulation schemes. There is a QAM, there is a whatever, there's a bunch of modulation schemes of different rates. So I could just assume directly a communication theoretic perspective, a bunch of modulation schemes, and some low rate, some high rate. The low rate ones are more robust, the high rate ones are less robust, right? Or, as I said, you could assume physical layer, you could assume path loss, SINR, all these things. Okay. So you could assume a more Shannon formula based approach, or you can directly work at a communication theory approach, it doesn't matter. Okay. I'm going to assume some notion of connectedness, and this actually turns out to be very, very, very important for the distributed computing aspects to go through. Some notion of connectedness. Now, let us suppose that all nodes transmit at maximum power. In fact, let me suppose that the entire world has switched on their transmitters and is jamming. So every one of you is jamming. And I'm trying to talk to Jonathan. So I send a signal to him. Suppose in spite of the fact that all of you are jamming, I can still talk to him at some modulation scheme. So there are a bunch of modulation schemes, right? At the lower strongest possible, most robust modulation scheme, supposing it's possible for me to talk to him even when everybody is jamming, then I will say there is an edge between us. So an edge is a worst case edge. Okay? So we'll say there's an edge between two nodes when they can communicate at the lowest rate modulation scheme and all other nodes are jamming. There is a more physical notion which I'm going to. I'm going to assume that this graph is connected. Actually, I don't need this assumption. It turns out that if this graph is disconnected, then you may as well assume that you have two separate subproblems. So it's not strictly speaking necessary. It just makes it convenient. Okay. In fact, I'm going to assume that the subgraph of good nodes is connected. So you, in this graph, remove the bad nodes, and there's a subgraph of good nodes that's connected. Actually, this also is not necessary, because if it is not, then I can try to work with it as two separate subproblems. Okay. All right. Clocks. I'm going to assume that every node has a local clock. This local clock is linear, linear with respect to Greenwich Mean Time. Okay? So every clock has a local clock which is linear. Now, if it is a accurate clock, the slope of this clock should be 1, right? All clocks should tick 1 second per second, right? If that is, the slope is 1, but they may not be. So I'll assume that there is a skew, which may be slightly different from 1. I'll assume that it is bounded above and below, bounded by half, below by half, and above by 2, or some number. So I'm just going to assume that no two clocks are infinitely faster. There's not one which is infinitely faster than the other. There's some bound. Okay. But I'm assuming clocks are linear. I'm going to make life more difficult for myself by assuming that clocks are digital, not analog. Why is that more difficult? Because digital clocks will tick now and will tick later, but between the two ticks, I don't know what time it is. So that actually creates problems in trying to estimate each other's skew. Inaccuracies because I'm getting quantization effects. Okay? And also, I'm going to make life more difficult for myself by assuming that clocks wrap around. It means after reaching 1,000,000, a clock will come back to 0 and go round and round. And this actually is a very difficult, difficult problem in cryptography, because if clocks wrap around, then I can fake a packet in spite of cryptography. I'll tell you why. Let us say that Jonathan sends a packet to somebody at 8 o'clock. Now, I don't know the cryptography involved in that packet, but I can just record that waveform. Now, within that packet, Jonathan may have said, hey, listen, I'm sending it to you at 8 o'clock. So if I were to send it at if I were to retransmit that packet at 9 o'clock, you'd say, wait, that's not a true packet, because it was sent at 8, and you're telling me it's 9, so it's not true. But if clocks wrap around, then if I replay that packet later, you may think it's Jonathan. So when clocks wrap around, there's something called replay attack that can happen without violating cryptographic assumptions. Okay? So this actually makes things a little bit more difficult. Okay. System startup. I'm going to assume that there's a primordial Big Bang birth of this universe. And I'll assume that this all nodes are born within a bounded time of each other. So all planets are born within 1,000,000 years. Okay, that's my assumption. If you get rid of this, it turns out to be a much more difficult problem. If people can be born at any time with no bound, the theory can be carried out. Jonathan has worked it out, that theory also. It's more difficult, but I'm not going to talk about it. So primordial birth. I'm also going to assume delay. Delay in when a node sends a packet to another node, node I sends a packet to node J, I'll assume that there is a delay Dij from sending to reception. Okay? Now I'm going to allow for this delay Dij to be different from Dji. But you'd say, wait a second, why should delay from I to J be different from J to I? That's because this delay is not just electromagnetic propagation delay. It includes all the technological issues involved. For example, when I want to send a packet, I first timestamp the packet. Then I may do some cryptography, etc., etc. Then I'll give it to medium access control in the network. That will choose when to transmit it. All that, the operating system will have to interrupt and so on. So there's a lot of operating system computational work that needs to be done. Then only the electromagnetic propagation delay takes over. And at the receiving side, there'll be a lot of operating system interrupts and so on in order to decode the packet. So delay is actually all these operating system interrupts, which are more than the propagation distance, okay? I mean, light travels about 1 foot in a nanosecond. So for the kind of networks we're interested in, that's a small amount. So these operating systems, huh? Yes. Exactly. So I'm assuming heterogeneous computing platforms. Because of that, encoding, decoding, etc., may involve different delays. The operating system loading may be different. Therefore, these delays, in the real world, they're timestamped this way, right? Before the operating system, before doing any other packet operations. So I'm including that possibility. Okay? And then I said I also assume all the cryptographic stuff, private key, public key. And I'm assuming there is some utility function, and this gets to a subtle point. This utility will only be measured over the conforming pairs. Okay? Of course. Okay, so this is my model. So let's see, what have I done here? So I've told you my world, my wireless networking world has some ingredients. Nodes have clocks. Clocks are linear, but they may be off. I said that every node has a transmitter and there's a bunch of modulation schemes. Low rate modulation, high rate modulation. I've also said something about jamming. You can take your node jam, and then you can jam my transmission. And if I can still talk to you, then we can somehow talk to each other, and I'm assuming some notion of connectivity for that graph. I'm also assuming cryptography and so on. And what else? I said nodes are not mobile, okay, etc. So this is my world, my networking model. Within this model, I'm going to prove my theorems. So if you want to write the next paper, you're going to have to come up with a better model. You're going to say, I don't like this model. You said no mobility, I'm going to allow mobility. Or you said something else, and I have something else. In fact, there are some issues with our model, which I will talk about later. You'll notice, or maybe I'll mention that later. Okay. To talk of, tell you some preliminaries, and then I will need to consult with Jonathan for a second because all clocks are not synchronized here. Okay, so I want to tell you a little bit about preliminaries about clocks over wireless networks. So a little digression here just to tell you something about clocks. So it turns out that more and more knowledge of time is important in networks, okay? For sensor networking applications, if you want to do triangulation by time of flight, you need time. If you want to do network control, then closing loops, delays are critical. And for security, we're going to see that synchronization is helpful, okay? Now the problem is no two clocks agree. Clocks may have a different offset and they may have a different skew, right? So what how to synchronize clocks in wireless networks. And also, there's another aspect. So there are two aspects. How to synchronize clock in a wireless network? Because if you synchronize clocks, you can use it for security. But the reverse problem is the synchronization itself, how secure is it? Because everything we do is being attacked, including synchronization, including handshakes, everything. Okay, so I want to tell you a little bit about clocks, and then maybe at that point I'll hand over to Jonathan. Okay, so first I want to tell you that it is impossible to synchronize two clocks. Impossible. So let us suppose that I have two clocks, one and two. The delay in one way is 1, 2. The delay in the reverse direction is 2, 1, D2, 1. And the clocks are linear. This is clock one's time, clock two's time. The characteristic is a linear characteristic. That slope is called the skew, and then there is an offset. So this problem is described by four parameters, an offset, a skew, and two delays, four parameters. If you want these clocks to be synchronized, these four parameters will have to be figured out, right? I'm going to theorem, it is impossible to determine these four parameters through any sequence of packet exchanges. Impossible. Okay. Proof is actually trivial, so I'm going to show you. Let us say that this is clock one, clock two, the timeline. And let us say that node one sends a packet at local time S1, and it is received at remote time R1. Okay? And there's a delay, D12, measured in local time. Now, what is the formula for R1? It's very simple. I send it at S1, it takes a local delay, D12, but that time has to be transformed into the coordinates of clock 2, and that coordinate is offset plus skew. So this is the relationship between the sent time and the received time, if one is sending to 2. If you send a packet in the reverse direction, that is you send at remote time S2 and it's received at local time R2, there's another formula. The formula is take the remote time, subtract D21, and transform it to coordinates. That's the send time. So the point is, and you can keep doing this all day long, and every time you send the packet, you get some equation of this form. Okay? And you can take all those equations and form a linear system of equations. In this linear system of equations, the unknown quantities are these four things, A2, B2, D12, D21. I've done a nonlinear one-to-one onto invertible transformation of these parameters, but that doesn't matter. This is the four parameters, okay? And the rest are all timestamps that the packets can exchange with each other. So this matrix is known, this vector is known, and they have to figure out this. So they have to solve this set of linear equations. Now, if you look at this matrix, you'll find that it's of rank 3. Why? If you subtract this column from this column, look at this column. Now, if it's rank 3, there's no way you can figure out four parameters. So, therefore, it is impossible to synchronize two nodes. Now, this should be a simple result, right? Yeah. Okay. Actually, this has some interesting questions. I mean, if you go back now to physics and talk of how would I know what time it is, there's some very interesting questions. But then we have to agree on what time is zero. So I don't know that either. Yeah. That's just a question of local coordinates, so it's not possible. Okay, so what can be determined? Well, it turns out you can determine the skew. I can tell that your clock is twice as fast as mine, that's easy. And the reason is this, you know, I'll send two packets 1 hour apart. And if you get them 2 hours apart, then your clock is twice as fast as mine. So that's possible to do. I can also determine the round trip delay. One way to do that is I quickly send your packet and you send it back to me. That's a round trip delay. Okay, so that can be figured out. Here's an interesting capability, and this actually turns out to be very important. Even though we cannot synchronize our packets, I can predict the time at which you will get a packet. For example, I can send a packet and say you will get it at 3 o'clock. According to your clock. And you will get it at 3 o'clock according to your clock. Even though I don't know when 3 o'clock is according to your clock. So even though I don't know your clock, I can predict to you when you will get a packet according to your local time. Okay? So the sender can predict the receiver's time at which the receiver receives a packet. So I can schedule packets to reach you at certain times according to your clock. That capability is possible even without synchronization. What is not possible? Offset is unknown. Here's a simple way to think about it. I cannot disambiguate delay from offset. I cannot separate them. Here's a simple way to think about it. Supposing I send a packet to you at 1 o'clock and you get it at 3 o'clock. Two things are possible. Even if the skew is 1, I cannot tell whether your clock was 2 hours ahead of mine all our clocks were synchronized perfectly, but the delay was 2 hours. I can never separate them. If I send you at 1, you receive at 3. I don't know whether the delay was 0 and you were 2 hours ahead of me, or we are clocks are the same but delay is 2. It's not possible to separate them. Okay? So it represents an indeterminable degree of freedom, and the delays are affine functions of the unknown offset. That's what this is saying. Now, there are some other things which are escaping. And all of those theorems can be easily stated by looking at this matrix. And then you know that when the rank is 3, then there's 1 degree of freedom. So you can determine the set of all solutions as a particular solution plus everything in the null space, right? So by just studying that to death, you can determine all these things, okay? All right. But the point is this. There are 3 capabilities we have. I can determine your skew, the round trip delay, and I can tell you the time at which you'll get a packet. All the security, all the results that we'll use will, can only use those three things, and it will only use those things. Yeah. Sorry? Okay. So now on to the scheme, and this is where I should consult. So, do you want to take over from here